2000. He has many, many honors. I won't talk for all of them. He was the recipient of the 2007 Buckley Prize in Physics, which is the highest honor the American Physical Society gives in condensed matter physics. And in 2012, he was elected to the National Academy of Sciences. So he has many, many research interests, but most of them focus on interacting electron systems. He's worked on problems with the quantum Hall effect, fractional quantum Hall effect, the spin Hall effect, spin transfer torques, which is dear to my heart, magnetic semiconductors, spin orbit interactions. And according to Wikipedia, his work is cited 12,000 times and has an H index of 69. So you have to believe it if it's Wikipedia. But it's really a pleasure to have him here to tell us about excitons and how we can make superconductors out of them.
Thanks, Andy.
Okay, so it's a pleasure to have a chance to come to the big city and also to chat with your students. I had a nice time chatting with your students and with Andy and Aditi. My topic today is connected to some elementary and very fundamental ideas in statistical physics, and also about some less developed ideas about doing something useful based on different kinds of things related to Bose condensation. So let me start at the very beginning notion of Bose condensation goes back, of course, to the very beginnings of quantum statistical physics and maybe to this letter written by Bose from present-day Bangladesh to Einstein, asking for his opinion on work where he invented the idea, I guess, of Bose statistics for quanta of light. And which of course we now know is correct. But the way in which this idea is connected with my talk, anyway, was first understood by Einstein. This is a calculation that many of you, most of you, I would guess, have done at some point in your life. It was first done by Einstein. This is a calculation in Einstein's own hand of the density of Bose particles that can fit into a thermal cloud at finite temperature. And you see that even Einstein has to be careful and check that his equations are correct. And the most important property of this expression he derived using Bose statistics for the density of particles in a Bose particles in an incoherent thermal cloud at finite temperature is that it's finite. The sum is converges, and there's only a finite number of particles in a system of Bose particles that can fit into the incoherent thermal cloud. And the consequences Einstein understood was that all of the leftover particles would be in the same quantum mechanical state. And that's what we mean by Bose condensation. And Bose condensates have two very characteristic properties. One is, represented by this equation, when you remove particles from a Bose condensate, there's a finite probability every time you remove a particle that it will be in the same quantum state and have the same quantum wave function with the same phase. And so that means that a Bose condensate will behave in a phase coherent way, even though it's made up of a bunch of different particles. It's basically makes single particle quantum mechanics macroscopic. And the other important property of Bose condensates which I think was first understood by Kapitza, was that Bose condensates would be superfluids. And essentially what happens if you put, if a finite fraction of all of the particles are in the same quantum state, and you put those particles in a finite momentum state, then no single particle scattering process can make that, can change the state that's occupied by many electrons. So this current flowing in a superfluid won't decay, and that gives rise to all of the phenomena that we associate with superfluidity, and that will be important in what I'm going to talk about today.
I thought it was done by Kapitza, but understood by Landau.
Okay,
No? You are there.
Don't ask me, you're not a historian. I read somewhere. Maybe you could say.
It's a long story, but he's close to the truth. But I think it was understood by London before it was understood by Landau. And
okay.
In many ways more clearly.
Okay. Okay. So the type of Bose condensation I'm going to talk about is different from what I've said so far. It's got to do with electronic properties, and it's got to do with condensation of pairs of electrons. Since electrons, of course, are fermions, pairs of electrons are bosons, and superconductivity is essentially Bose condensation bound states of electrons, Cooper pairs inside a metal. And so this superfluidity is very closely connected with the common phenomena of superconductivity in metals, in which current flows without decay. But what I'm going to talk about is not quite that. It's instead condensation not of pairs of electrons, not amplitudes for removing pairs of particles from a system of electrons, but instead making electron-hole pairs, pairs in which you have, in the most common case, people have thought about for longest, a pair consisting of a missing state in the valence band of a semiconductor, let's say, and a electron in the conduction band of a semiconductor. So these electron-hole pairs often behave like bosons, and they can both condense, and as we'll discuss, that those Bose condensates can carry supercurrents. Actually, this kind of superconductivity is one language for describing well-known phenomena in ferromagnets that I'll talk about toward the end of my talk. Okay. So excitons. Okay. So excitons, as most of you know, are elementary excitations of insulators or semiconductors. You shine light on a semiconductor. You make particle-hole pairs. The particles in the hole get stuck in a bound state. And that electron-hole pair acts like a particle with Bose statistics, and can Bose condense? And people have been looking for Bose condensates of that kind of object for a long time, and perhaps have seen lots of evidence of Bose statistics of systems contain many bosons. But as you just saw, one of the complicated things about this type of experiment is that these excitons, which are excited states of a semiconductor, are only present in large numbers and non-equilibrium states. And what I'm going to talk about mainly is about systems in which we have electrons and holes and excitons in equilibrium, because I'm interested in transport properties, and those kinds of experiments perhaps aren't possible in equilibrium. Okay, so, but nevertheless, let me continue a little bit about, in this introduction, about excitons in equilibrium. This is a paper, a very early paper. As far as I know, perhaps it's the first paper that talks about Bose-Einstein condensation of excitons. You can see the authors of this paper were from New York University. I'm not sure if these authors are still part of the institutional memory of this department or not. They are. Good. And in this early paper, people talked about the possibility of making many excitons, thermalizing them, and forming a Bose-condensed superfluid state. And one of the statements in this paper, which seems natural enough, is that since excitons are electron hole pairs, unlike Cooper pairs in a superconductor, they don't carry a charge, and therefore the authors concluded they can't expect that their condensation will give rise to any interesting electrical effects. So you see in my talk, I'm going to talk about exactly interesting electrical effects associated with exciton condensation. And so we'll see why that's possible now and perhaps unthinkable in 1962. This is another paper a little bit later from the literature about this interesting kind of state of matter. And these authors, this is a paper by Walter Cohen and David Sherrington, made the point that if you made a state with a bunch of excitons and they condensed, they wouldn't be a superfluid state. And what they really had in mind here is, as I said, a superfluid state you can think of as a state in which many particles are in a finite momentum state, current-carrying state, in which the phase of the wave function depends on position in a particular way. And they are making the point here that there will, when you make real electron hole pairs, there will always be something that prefers a particular value of that phase. And you won't get plane wave states, and therefore you won't get superfluid states. And so we'll see that that statement is, although in some academic sense correct, is also not that important for phenomena. Okay. So exciton condensates are not superfluids, even of neutral objects, it would seem. Okay, my next thing I want to talk about a little bit is about some experiments and which are what got me interested in this problem. And let me first show you this experiment from the laboratory of Jim Eisenstein at Caltech. This is a recent PRB paper. I'll come back to this experiment again in a few minutes after I say a few other things. For now, I just want to say, first of all, it's a experiment done on two-layer electron systems. They're actually two-layer systems with electrons in one layer and holes in the other layer. And I'll say a little more precisely what I mean by that a little later. But it's important that it's a two-layer system. And they're doing an electrical measurement, and as you can see, at least for the moment, by this break in this curve, something electrical happens that's interesting in these systems. So these experiments, this system is actually a bilayer or spatially indirect exciton condensate system. And there have been many experiments done on the electrical properties of these systems over the last 10 or 15 years, principally by Jim Eisenstein and by Klaus von Klitzing in Stuttgart. And I'll come back and show you a couple more of these experiments in a moment. So I have to elaborate a little bit. So how can I get electrons and holes in equilibrium? So electrons are, you know, states in some band of a material, conduction band, let's say. and holes are missing states in some other band. And you can imagine that if I have a two-layer system, I can make the valence band in one layer cross the conduction band of another layer. And so that you can have in equilibrium, you can have, without having to make an excitation, you can have electrons in one system and holes in the other system. And I'm going to talk about that type of system at the end of my talk. But these experiments are actually not done in that way. Instead, they're done in semiconductor quantum wells in which electrons are in both layers. So just using semiconductor heterojunctions, electrons are confined to two different layers, actually, in gallium arsenide semiconductors with aluminum gallium arsenide barriers. And the Fermi level lies in the conduction band of both of these layers, which are separated by 10 nanometers or so. And the fact that these exciton condensates occur is related to the fact that that these experiments are done in a strong magnetic field. So in without a magnetic field, when I have electrons confined to a two-dimensional cis plane, they have a continuous density of states that's actually independent of energy. But when you add a magnetic field, the electrons orbits get bent around into closed cyclotron orbits, and the kinetic energy gets quantized. And so it's not regular conduction and valence bands we're talking about here, but Landau levels or Landau bands, if you like. And you can arrange a system where you have electrons in conduction band in the two different layers and two different Landau levels. And you can, each Landau band has some number of states. You can talk about these electronic states in this two-layer system either in terms of, you know, electrons in the Landau level states of each layer, or you can make a particle hole transformation within one of the Landau levels. So these are electron states in some Landau level of one layer, and missing states or holes in a Landau level of the other layer. So that's the type of electron hole pair that has condensed in these experiments, so-called magneto-exciton states.
So the two layers have to have different densities, different charge densities in order for this to occur?
So the two layers, it turns out that the let's say each layer, the most important thing is that the number of electrons in one Landau level is equal to the number of holes in the other Landau level, which means that the total number of electrons adding the two layers together is equal enough to fill up one of the two Landau levels, what we call filling factor one in quantum Hall effect systems. And it turns out that this phenomena occurs over a wide range of partitioning of density between the two layers, but it does occur when the filling factor, when each Landau level is half filled as well. Yeah. Although the words I've said might be most intuitive, when you have a low density of electrons at one Landau level and a low density of missing electrons in the other Landau level. But it occurs over a broad range of that electron and hole density. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the transport phenomena that occur in these systems. I should have said, so what happens when I have these systems in Landau bands or Landau levels, and a number, you know, the electrons in one Landau band match the holes in the other, equal in number of the holes in the other Landau band. We know, in fact, essentially exactly for this problem, that the ground state consists of a Bose condensate of excitons.
Why do they merge? Just because of electrostatic repulsion? Or?
Why do they?
Why would they care to merge each other? The holes in one layer and the electrons in another.
Have to be equal, you mean? No. So the number.
What's the reason for this matching between the two layers?
Yeah, so you can basically, you tune, can tune experiment to make experimental condition into this regime. So the electrostatics controls the number of electrons in each layer. The number of electrons that fit into a Landau band, you can continuously adjust for a magnetic field. With a magnetic field, it's equal to the number of flux quanta that go through the two-dimensional electron system. So the
reason for pairing between holes and electrons isn't just electrostatic attraction.
The reason it forms this state is electrostatic attraction. Yes. But the condition, this exciton condensed state only occurs when the number of electrons in one Landau level equals the number of holes in the other Landau level. And to get to that condition, you have to go to a particular magnetic field strength for a given 2D system, let's say. Okay. All right, so I was saying, so under this special circumstance where the number of electrons and number of holes, we know that the ground state has an excitation gap. It's the excitation gap that's necessary to break apart one of these electron-hole pairs.
That's a theoretical result.
That there's an excitation gap?
Well, that you get this post-condensation.
It was kind of known, perhaps not exactly in this language, but it was kind of known theoretically before anybody realized there were interesting experimental consequences.
Right, but that theoretical result neglects electron-electron interactions.
That the ground state is a condensate? No, it includes electron-electron interactions. It depends on electron-electron interactions.
No, between the two, but inside each level. I mean, inside each level in a magnetic field, you get quantum Hall states and God knows what. But
right.
That's not part of this.
No, it is. In the following sense. So let's imagine there's a limit in which you can make a rigorous statement including all interactions. That limit is the limit in which the separation between the two layers is small compared to the other relevant length scale, which is actually the length scale that characterizes the area occupied by each electron, the magnetic length. In that limit, there's an argument, very similar to the arguments first made by Bob Laughlin to understand the fractional quantum Hall effect, that tells you when I have two layers here and I have a total filling factor, number of electrons equals the number of holes, using a very similar type of argument and using the fact that, but appealing to the fact that the interaction between the layers is not layer dependent. So you have to use that symmetry, then you can kind of rigorously show that the ground state is an exciton condensate. And so the fact that the interaction between electrons in different layers is actually a little weaker than the interaction of between electrons within the same layer, that has to be treated as some kind of perturbation, and we only know how to do that approximately. So there was good reason to think, at least. So the limit of small layer separation, we knew theoretically that the ground state was an exciton condensate. And you could estimate in various ways the critical layer separation at which it would no longer be an exciton condensate. And once experiments were done, we realized those estimates were not terribly bad, but not exact. Okay. So I'm going to talk about transport in systems with electrons and holes in which I have an exciton condensate, and I'm going to make an analogy to perhaps the case of Bose condensation, which has the most interesting transport properties, and that's superconductors. And I'm going to make an analogy with a well-known type of phenomenon in superconductors, for which I have this bad cartoon here, in which I'm imagining I have a circuit, a wire, which has in blue normal electron regions and regions, and in red a superconducting region. So if I have a wire like this and I try to drive a current through it, in a superconductor there's an energy gap at the Fermi level. So you might think that it would be impossible to inject an electron moving along at the Fermi energy from the normal metal into the superconductor. And indeed, if a normal electron comes along and it can't get into a superconductor because there's an energy gap in the superconductor. And that process in which a normal electron scatters off a superconductor, it's possible because in the superconductor I have this amplitude for having creating or removing pairs of particles. And so that's the order parameter, if you like, of a superconductor. And the quasi-particles of the superconductor violate particle number conservation because they can convert particles between quasi-particles and the number of Cooper pairs that have condensed. And so it's possible for an electron from a normal metal hitting a superconductor to scatter off of particle number breaking terms in a superconductor, scatter back as a whole, but then particle number conservation is restored by launching a superconductor, adding an extra Cooper pair to the superconductor, and that superconductor in the steady state will satisfy current conservation and carry the current through the superconductor. So that under that circumstance, if you drive a current through this system, the current will flow through the superconductor in the form of Cooper pairs. And in terms of the superconducting order parameter, that means that I have a bunch of Cooper pairs in a finite momentum state, and the phase of the superconducting order parameter has a spatial gradient corresponding to the momentum of those Cooper pairs. Okay? So that's what happens in a superconductor, and something very similar, I will say, happens in these exciton condensate systems. Here's a cartoon for that. This is from a paper I wrote a number of years ago, and the experiment that I showed you at the beginning of this section is really a realization of this kind of geometry that we imagine in this experiment. So what's imagined here is a bilayer system with a top layer and a bottom layer. That's what T and B stand for, top and bottom. L and R are left and right. So I'm imagining this as a 1D conducting channel from left to right. When I have this bilayer exciton condensate state, I actually have an energy gap because I have a condensate of electron hole pairs, and it takes a finite energy to break them apart. And so if I have this bilayer, I can arrange experimentally so that the number of electrons in each layer is separately conserved, that the processes which allow electrons to somehow get from one layer to the other are suppressed to any desirable degree so that they're unmeasurable. In that case, what happens is the order parameter of the exciton condensate state is an amplitude for electron hole pairs. When an electron scatters off that, it can scatter from top layer to bottom layer even though there's no real tunneling available from top layer to bottom layer. But when it does so, it has to make an exciton and to separately conserve the number of particles in each layer, just like Andreev reflection launches Cooper pairs. And so if you imagine this type of geometry, that if you have this bilayer system, and if you just, for example, connected the top layer electrically, if this connection in the bottom layer was open, then you would not be able to send a current through this at the Fermi level because there's an energy gap. But when you connect it in this way, every time an electron comes in, it launches an exciton, and when a hole is created here, then to conserve, let me say it this way. The excitons are launched, they move across the system, and the electron can exit in the circuit on the top layer. In the bottom layer, the whole part of the excitons moving from left to right conserve charge in the bottom layer, this hole current here has to be matched by an electron current that flows in this way around this wire. That's a picture for what happens. Let me go back to this experiment. This is actually, the red line is the Let me switch to the blue one. So this is an experiment in which current is injected in the top layer and removed from the bottom layer. So whenever I inject an electron in the top layer, I make excitons. If I remove it from the bottom layer, I also make excitons. And if you connect to a bilayer exciton condensate in this way, then you're continuously injecting excitons into the system. And what happens is that if you allow some tunneling between the layers, as I said, this tunneling can be suppressed as much as you like, but if you allow tunneling between the layers for a little while, you actually are allowed to make excitons, and that can be they can be absorbed by coherent tunneling of excitons between the layers. Beyond some maximum current, you can no longer do that, so there's a break in this curve, and you get into a regime where there's normal incoherent single particle tunneling of electrons from layer to layer in this case. And this is actually the effect that I'm going to imagine that we can exploit. I forgot, somehow deleted the wrong slide from my transparency. So let me just say in words, if you do this experiment and open up this connection, then you measure a very large resistance. If you allow current to flow here, then you find that that when you do this measurement, a current can easily flow through the top layer, and then whenever the current flows through the top layer, then somehow magically a current starts, an equal magnitude current flows through this loop, just as in this cartoon.
But this effect can only be described as drag. You need excitonic fields. I mean, you could also have just Coulomb drag between layers without having excitons.
What Aditi is referring to is a well-known phenomena in which you have a current flowing in one, let's say, for example, two-dimensional conductor, and Coulomb interactions between, let's say friction between electrons flowing in one layer can induce a current in the other layer. So in that case, it is true you can get a current in the bottom layer induced by the top layer, but that current's always, a part in a million of the current. current in the top layer. Here they're exactly equal. Okay. So let's come back to this curve. So this is a this is an IV curve for transport through a system containing an exciton condensate. In this case, intentionally, some tunneling amplitude between the layers was allowed. The voltage that's measured here is, this says VEX, that means external voltage. So this voltage that's plotted here is actually mainly just a contact resistance voltage associated with the current flowing through the system. You can also measure the tunneling voltage associated with this blue curve. The voltage difference between the top layer and the bottom layer when the current is under this circumstance where you're making current go from top layer to bottom layer. And and this is what you measure. So this is current as a function of voltage measured in a bilayer system between top layer and bottom layer. And there's a clear separation here that you can get lots of current with voltages that are basically small enough that they have so far been unable to measure them. Lots of current flowing between these two layers, which have very weak tunneling. I won't go into the theory of the magnitude of this current, but it's understood as proportional to the strength of the interlayer tunneling. And basically corresponds to all electrons coherently being in a state with the same linear combination of top and bottom layer, which maximizes the current flow. And then once you reach that maximum current, then something happens. You go into this normal incoherent tunneling from layer to layer. And then you measure a sizable voltage between the top layer and the bottom layer. And the main point I want to make here is that a certain amount of current can flow between these two layers with essentially no tunneling voltage. And the amount of current that can flow between the layers you can control by controlling the strength of the interlayer tunneling. And
is this analogous to the Josephson effect in some ways? I mean, it looks like
it's partly analogous to Josephson effect. These IV curves look very much like Josephson IV curves. Maybe the analogy is not complete, but it's certainly partly analogous.
So it's dissipative-less current. It's a current that flows without dissipation.
Well, it's certainly current flowing with voltages that you can't, too small to measure. So the main point I want to make about this is summarized by these experiments. So let me, here's the bilayer system again. You notice here that the bilayer, the two-dimensional electron layers, the two different two-dimensional electron layers, are in the form of rings, which is kind of hard for the experimenters. And the reason for that is because the one-dimensional transport that I was talking about through a gapped region is from outside to inside. Some of this story is a little complicated a little bit by the fact that many of you may know that you always have edge states associated with the quantum Hall effect. And so in order to have current flow through a region that's gapped for electron excitations and therefore has to be carried by excitons, you have to flow from outside to inside. But if you want to compare with my cartoons, outside to inside is just my one-dimensional conduction channel. And outside here is, let's say, the left side of the conductor, and inside is the right side of the conductor. This red curve is just the curve I showed you before. Something's not quite projecting on the bottom here. This is actually current flowing measured out here, I2. It's actually plotted versus I1 for certain, these three different curves are three different values of V2, and the curve is generated by varying V1. But the main thing I want to emphasize is these vertical bars are the regions where you have essentially dissipationless current flowing between the two layers. These always occur where the length of these bars, as I was trying to explain before, you can continuously adjust experimentally by adjusting the amount of tunneling between the two layers. So we understand this what controls the length of these bars, the regions of current over which you can have a nearly dissipationless current. And they're centered around the sum of the two currents. So what's important is not where we're injecting excitons into this bilayer system, but simply the total number of excitons that we inject per unit time into the bilayer system. And because it's this sort of violation of separate particle number conservation, which can only be violated to a controllable extent. So you can see that this gives rise to very non-local transport properties. The region between inside and outside is an insulator. It has no electronic excitations. Nevertheless, the IV properties at the outside of the system and the inside of the system are intimately connected, and they're intimately connected by the fact that excitons are generated when current flows from top to bottom, and they spread throughout the system. Okay. So the other,
some sense, insulating as far as single particle properties go, but if you look at collective properties.
It has gapless. Certainly has gapless collective excitons. Yeah. So this is obviously, if I ignore interlayer tunneling, it's an XY type superfluid, right? With normal phonon type modes. And okay. The other thing that's interesting about these IV curves is they're sharper than KT. So this is an example of a paradigm that maybe can create a breakthrough in electronic technology. I think most of you know that your computers aren't getting faster as quickly as they used to. And the reason for that mainly is that too much heat is generated in electronic devices. And the problem is that all of the logic in these devices is based on switches that control the motion of individual electrons. And to control whether an individual electron goes here or there, you have to change a barrier by many times the thermal fluctuation energy, KT. And so that means that you have to have voltages that are at least, let's say, an order of half a volt. And so every time you do a switch, you have to have a half a volt times however number of electrons you need to charge up a capacitor. And that's too much energy. And so people need a kind of logic where each switch consumes less power. And here, if you have something that controls the collective motion of many electrons, something you can change that controls the collective motion of many electrons, then you still have a limit that that collective variable has to have potential landscape that switches by many times kT, but many times kT can move all of the electrons you want. And that's, so people talk about that in many different contexts. For example, maybe phase change devices where you have metal insulator transitions controlled by some voltage or something. But here's another example where you have something that that it's not single electron transport by the fact that the dependence on a voltage switching knob is much smaller than kT. So in fact, there is my electrical engineering colleagues. We actually get money for this. And because semiconductor industry is kind of desperate, and they see the end coming, and so they're interested in any even quite far out ideas for switches that might consume less power. And my electrical engineering friends have actually invented very extremely low power electrical device they call a bilayer pseudospin field effect transistor, BISFET, based on these kinds of electrical characteristics.
What temperature is this experiment done at?
Okay, so that brings me to the last part of my talk. I have 15 minutes or so left. Everything I've told you so far, nothing takes place beyond temperatures above 300 millikelvin. And so that phenomena in semiconductor quantum
is above 300.
No, everything I've showed you takes place below 300 millikelvin. Mm-hmm. And so in order to use this in some kind of practical thing, then you need to have these kinds of electrical characteristics at room temperature. It's some kind of superfluidity at room temperature. It's superfluidity based, as people were saying, on electrostatics. So it doesn't require the sort of subtlety of superconductivity, in which somehow electrons are tricked into ignoring electrostatics and getting bound into pairs. We have to find some way of, or we're interested in exploring different ideas for how these kinds of phenomena could occur at room temperature, and I'll tell you about some of those ideas. Okay, this is the first idea, I think we kind of almost know this idea doesn't work, but the idea is, I want to have electrons and holes in real bands, not in Landau bands. And I want to have lots of electrons and holes so that the energy scales associated with them are big. And the idea was try to make lots of electron holes in system with two layers of graphene. And as most of you know, graphene is a material that's made of carbon atoms and a single carbon atom thick. And at the Fermi level, there's a band crossing, so it's like a semiconductor with no band gap, a gapless semiconductor. And it's a linear band crossing, so it has these Dirac cone-like energy bands at low energies. So if I have two of these layers, I can use external gates to shift energies up and down at different amounts in the different layers, so that the Fermi level lies in the valence band of one layer, the red layer here, and in the conduction band of another layer, the blue layer, and I can always arrange the gates so that that the overall system is electrically neutral, so the number of extra electrons in the conduction band of one layer is exactly equal to the number of holes in the valence band of the other layer, and that's exactly the condition that's favorable for exciton condensation, because electrons equals holes, and actually it's also helpful that the Fermi surfaces of the holes and the electrons are identical. And so why is graphene bilayers a good system for this kind of thing? Well, what we initially thought was the fact that graphene is a gapless semiconductor was a good thing, because you could, if you put an electric field between two graphene layers, then in equilibrium you immediately start to get electrons in one layer and holes in the other layer. You don't have to put an electric potential difference between the layers that already crosses the band gap of the semiconductor before you start to induce carriers. And also, you know, what's just generally interesting about these atomic layer thick two-dimensional materials is that compared to the semiconductor systems I was talking about earlier, is that you can have much higher carrier densities. The reason is that in the semiconductors, the quantum wells that confine the electrons are actually have don't have very big barriers. So if you have electric fields, you'll just sweep electrons out of those quantum wells. But that's not true in these atomic layer thick materials. So you can have very high carrier densities, a couple of orders of magnitude at least larger than in the semiconductor systems. And also helps a bit is that they're particle hole symmetric. So you can do a mean field theory for electron hole exciton condensation in graphene. It's the same as the theory of superconductivity, and you can make optimistic estimates of critical temperatures, and some progress has been made experimentally in getting graphene layers into regimes where they're actually close enough together, where interactions between the layers are starting to get strong. So far, nobody, well, maybe there are some weak indications, but certainly exciton condensation, if it occurs in these systems, is not that robust. Okay, and you know, the main reason I think why this graphene doesn't work is what Pierre was alluding to before, and that is I have these two different layers, actually, you know, approximately half filled pi bands in each layer, and the interactions between electrons within each layer are very important. There's a high density of electrons in each layer. In the filled valence band even, and those correlations, the competition between those correlations and the electron hole pairing is difficult to account for theoretically. And therefore, here's try number two. And I still have time for a couple more tries. And so this is another class of two-dimensional materials where lots of interesting experiments have been done recently. I'll say the material specifically I have in mind in the moment. But I'm imagine that instead of two layers, each containing a two-dimensional gapless semiconductor. I have two layers, each containing an ordinary semiconductor with a layer, with an energy gap. Then if I can put an electric field to bring holes in one layer into equilibrium with electrons in the other layer, then I can talk about forming electron hole pairs here at low energies between these electrons and these holes, and these high density of other electrons are far away in energy and they don't matter so much. So this problem, if this energy gaps are big enough, or if the, strictly speaking, if the exciton binding energy is small compared to the energy gap of the semiconductor, this maps exactly to the so-called BCS-BEC crossover problem. This problem, unlike graphene, in this circumstance, the limit in which the electrons, two layers get very close together is indeed simple, and you can rigorously just deal with electrons of low density of electrons in one layer, low density of holes in the other. We know a lot about that problem, and we know it leads to Bose condensation. And so so it depends on this gap being big. You can have gaps in bilayer graphene. That's also an interesting system that's being studied. But the materials mainly I have in mind here are the so-called transition metal dichalcogenides. These are, again, another class of materials where you can make a truly atomic layer thick, two-dimensional material. And they're semiconductors. They have an energy gap. And what's more, there's a whole family of these materials because you can use different group 6 metal atoms and different chalcogens. And when you lay these materials one across the other, the band lineup between the valence band of some of these materials and the conduction band of some other ones is that this spatially indirect gap indicated in these cartoons, this is from a paper by Cho at UT Dallas, actually, but there are many similar papers in the literature. The actual numbers here are probably beyond the accuracy of density functional theory to really predict reliably. But nevertheless, it's clear that there are some cases where the gaps, spatially indirect gaps, are not very big, so we don't need very big electric fields. What's more, both the conduction and valence bands in these materials are D bands, which are very easy to localize into bound states. The exciton binding energies in within a single layer, the spatially direct ones in these materials, are very large. In many of these materials, they're more than half an EV, close to an electron volt, according to some interpretations of experiment. So even the spatially indirect exciton binding energies can be quite large, and really that's the thing in these in this case that sets the bound on TC. And okay, so that's a possible interesting system. If you could really make exciton condensates in this system, then it's hard to imagine a reason why you shouldn't be able to, but one doesn't know until it's achieved. Then you should be able to see those electrical transport properties, which so far have only been seen at very low temperatures. Go ahead.
So you're talking about higher temperature.
Yeah, so the limit on TC is roughly some number, which is probably smaller than one, times the exciton binding energy of a single exciton. And we know that, at least in the limit of zero separation between the layers, that's, in these systems, that's, you know, EVs, or close to an EV. So that translates into thousands, or let's say 1,000 degrees Kelvin. So room temperature doesn't seem implausible. Okay, so finally, let me end with a case in which we know we have collective behavior at room temperature, and that's the case of ferromagnets. So I've been talking about phenomena associated with exciton condensation. These are really states, a ground state, in which you have macroscopic coherence between electrons and holes. And there's really no difference between these types of systems, essentially, and ferromagnets. Ferromagnets are systems in which many spins collectively align. You know a quantum spin you can view as a linear combination with a particular orientation as a coherent linear combination of up and down. And so the very similar phenomena occur in ferromagnets, and in fact, this is again an old idea. There's a very nice little review by Sonnen, you might find entertaining, written just recently in Journal of Low Temperature Physics. But let me just say a couple of words about this very quickly. As you can imagine, this analogy between what I've been talking about in ferromagnetism only occurs if the ferromagnetism is characterized by a single angle, by an orientation angle in a plane. So the magnetization has to be confined to a plane. Let's call it the XY plane. And let me make such, I can view such a magnet, if I like, as a Bose condensate of magnons. So magnons, we normally define, let's say we can start by the spin state where all spins are aligned in the spin up direction. If I make a single magnon, then I coherently, as a function of position, lower all of the spins. And if I want to make many magnons to lower, to take this magnetization and tilt it all the way into an XY plane, then I have to make many magnons, all with a given phase. And so this is just another language for describing an XY magnet. And that's one way of understanding that the same kind of phenomena occur in XY magnets. And let me skip a few of these. It doesn't matter whether the magnet is localized or itinerant. It does matter, and I won't take the time to explain this, it does absolutely matter that there be an anisotropy energy which creates an energy penalty of tilting the magnetization out of some particular XY plane. Otherwise, when you try to carry a current, the magnetization will just flip. Also, maybe I won't talk about this, but magnets are, there's no such thing as a real XY magnet. If I have a magnetization and the magnetization nearly wants to be in a plane, there will always be some weak dependence which prefers some particular orientation within that plane. The role of that is very much like the role of tunneling between the layers in the other problem I was talking about. Doesn't get in the way at all, as actually maybe Cohn and Sherrington thought of the interesting transport properties. Let me just, this is my last transparency. So this is, this cartoon is intended to suggest that people like Andy and others have been doing magical things with magnetic materials. They can do incredible things. And it seems like they can nearly make this thing I showed you in quantum Hall systems at below 300 millikelvin in a sort of messy sounding magnetic materials that all behave collectively at room temperature. So the analog of top layer and bottom layer is spins up and down. The analog of the bilayer exciton condensate is spins that are in the XY plane with some coherent orientation. And nowadays, people can make magnetic thin films where the magnetization likes to be perpendicular to the film, very thin films. They can make beautiful tunneling materials which purify the spins so that you get almost complete spin polarization of spins injected into different materials. This is not necessarily the best geometry. I'm going to ask Andy tomorrow what's the best geometry. This cartoon looks most similar to the one I showed you before. So you can control spins going from up to down, like top layer to bottom layer, at one end of an XY magnet, and separately, far away, controls spins going from up to down at a different point in the system. And the collective magnetic order in this ferromagnet, and there may be some advantages for being an insulating ferromagnet like yttrium, iron, garnet, the collective behavior of the magnetization of the system communicates the information of what's going on, what spins are being flipped at this end to the other end, and these two ends of the circuit behave collectively in just the way the phenomena I showed you for Bose-Einstein condensate. So this is my third try to go from 300 millikelvin to 300 kelvin, and I sure hope that one of these works one day. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So what set the 300 millikelvin? Was it the magnetic field?
The binding energy of the electron hole pairs in these systems is actually, in the quantum Hall systems, is actually around 5 Kelvin. It's not a very mean fieldy system, and the exciton order is I'm going to put a quote around that for a second. Is actually appears to be lost at around 300 millikelvin. So
because of strong interactions.
Yeah, and it's really, of course, it's 2D. It doesn't have long range order, but there's always some little bit of tunneling between the layers, so which cuts off the long wavelength fluctuations. Anyway, that's what it seems to be, that this physics disappears at about 300 millikelvin because, you know, basically the energy scales are around that size. The stiffness energy is, for example, I think around 1 degree Kelvin.
This last example, are you transporting magnons then between these different places coherently? Is that the idea of this picture here? The magnons basically propagate the.
You can view it as a supercurrent of magnons if
okay.
you like.
Okay.
But these are, you know, nothing I've described here is outside of the physics described by normal micromagnetic modeling. Importantly, with the, you know, spin torque terms, and the role of spin torque terms is to sort of bring approximate total spin conservation into the equations, and that approximate total spin conservation plays the same role as approximate total particle number conservation in in a superconductor, for example.
Okay. Yes. This is really interesting. Other questions?
Under any circumstance, spin 1 excitons could be produced that be useful for something, or?
Right. So the answer is probably, I don't know. But it's actually probably a very good question. And in these transition metal dichalcogenide systems that I was talking about, There are two valleys in the Bruin zone that go together in the exciton. So there's actually valley and spin degrees of freedom in the excitons. So there are lots of excitonic states. What role that will play in this phenomena, I don't know. I've been trying to think about that, but I don't really have anything very coherent to say at the moment.
Well, thank you very much, Alan. There'll be, of course, food and drink upstairs on the sixth floor. I hope you all join us and continue the discussion.